Imagine you have a relatively big Linux server. It has, let's say, 48 gigabytes of RAM and 8-core CPU. This server has a standard file system layout with well-familiar /var/tmp/etc and other directories. Your company doesn't really have an application that needs all of this memory and CPU at once. Instead, there are multiple applications that you need to run on this server. There is a Java web application, and there are some Python scripts to be executed periodically. You don't want to run these applications under the root user, because that would mean that each application can do anything it wants on the server, including accessing the files and directories of the other application. So, to isolate them from each other, you craft a beautiful directory layout, and then run each application under a different Linux user. To actually run the application, you create new systemd services for each app with C groups, making sure that system resources are managed properly. It works pretty well for some time, thanks to the proper combination of Linux users, file permissions, STLinux labels, and systemd unit definitions. You have a secure multi-tenant server. First problems appear during the next patching. One of the Python applications relies on a now outdated system package. You can't update this package because the application will break, and you can't leave this package as it is because it puts the whole server with all of the applications running there at risk. You've tried to isolate each application as much as possible with the help of STLinux, C groups, and multi-user setup, but the final frontier, the file system, remains shared between all applications. If you start looking closer, you will notice a couple of other things that remained shared. For example, each application shares the same process table. Your Python application is well aware of the existence of the Java application running on the same server. Your quest to properly isolate applications from each other becomes harder as you dive deeper into this topic. Wouldn't it be great if there was something to do this isolation for you? This is where containers come in. On the technical level, each container is just a Linux process that is isolated from the rest of the system with the help of the already mentioned and some extra tools. C groups, STLinux or AppArmor, standard Unix permissions, Linux namespaces, and Linux capabilities all work together to isolate this process in such a way that from inside the process, your application is not aware that it lives in a container. Container, then, is nothing but a useful abstraction to describe a process that is so isolated from every other process on the same server that it actually believes that this isolated box it runs in is the actual server. There is an old movie, The Truman Show. You might have seen it. The hero of this movie is oblivious to the fact that he is in a reality TV show since his birth. He lives under a huge dome, his friends and relatives are nothing but actors, and every place he knows is just a decoration for the show. If we translate this movie to the Linux world, then the container is the fake world for the process that lives in this world. The showrunners make sure that our process, the hero of our Linux Truman Show, never realizes that it has a fake file system, fake process table, fake networking, and everything else. We can only hope that, unlike Truman, our process will never escape this isolated little world and will not wreak havoc on the real server we have. You may ask, how is it different from virtualization? On a technical level, the big difference is that while containers are simply using existing Linux toolkit to isolate the process that is still running on the same Linux kernel, virtual machines can do a bit more complex things, including running not only different kernel versions, but even completely different operating systems on a single host. If container is a Truman Show-like decoration of a little town that is still located on the planet, then virtual machine is a space station located very far away from the Earth, communicating with it only via specialized channels, and even those channels are not visible to anyone on the station. The inhabitants of the space station are not aware of the existence of Earth. Their whole world is represented by this artificial environment. So, the approach to isolation is different between containers and virtual machines, and this leads to a slight conceptual difference between them. In the space station, the complete space station is a special environment dedicated to do many different things with complete isolation from the planet. And in the virtual machine case, it's the complete system that can run many processes and do lots of different tasks, just like the real server, but, well, virtualized. In the Truman Show, there is only one misled person, and in the container, there is only one process isolated from the real server. Containers are, by nature, very specialized to do just one particular task. And who is the showrunner of this container world? It's something called a container runtime. You probably don't want to set up Linux namespaces, C groups, and everything else from scratch for every new container you want to create. The tool that does it for you is called the container runtime, the lowest level utility of every container environment. But what's the name of this runtime? Well, it doesn't actually matter, and we will learn why it doesn't matter in the next video. If you or your company are interested in OpenShift or Kubernetes consulting and training, you can contact us via the email address provided in the description below. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and press the like button. Thanks for watching!